it's something that's slightly different from the everyday practices. She works in Seattle, has a collaboration with an XAA graduate near Porter here, as Gustafson Porter. And I think there's a whole range of different types of projects that are happening between the European office and the American office. I'm sure many of you are familiar because many of these projects have been published in the press. Their work for the Swiss Cottage Open Space in London, the Westergas Fabric Park in Amsterdam, and the Crystal Palace project that that started it all probably in the late 70s. Kathryn also moved to France, and again, I'm sure many of you are familiar with those early projects when she started doing landscape and environmental site-specific projects in France and studied there for her degree in landscape architecture. So I think there's a fantastic kind of range and mix of cultural backgrounds, different parts of the world, all coming together. The work of the practice has been very much recognized, in particular this week or last week when she received the Chrysler Award in New York, and I guess tomorrow she'll be receiving the Royal Design for Industry Award among many of the other awards that she's won. Please welcome Kathryn Gustafson.
Thank you. I almost tripped and fell on my face. That would have been wonderful. I feel like I don't know what's going on with technology. I'm sorry. As far as moving forward, yeah.
Just press forward on these two.
Okay.
Like that, if you want to.
Okay, got it. Okay.
If you want to reverse? Want
perfect.
On
I want them on.
On.
I can do it. Okay. Thank you. I haven't, I used to try to prepare all sorts of intelligent things to say about the work, and the more I tried to prepare them, the worse the lectures got. So I've decided not to try to prepare them this time. What I am going to do is, another thing I've never done before, is I'm going to show a lot of unbuilt work. I've been very afraid to show unbuilt work because you never know how a project's going to turn out. And so if you promise something and then it turns out really awful, then everybody knows about it and everybody goes sees it and you're sort of caught, you know, between the rock and hard place. But at this point, their projects take so long to get built that a lot of these have been started since 97. They're just on site now. It looks like they're going to work out, so I am going to show them. I've also split the lecture into sort of scale relationships. So we're starting out at a very big scale, and then we'll move from large land movement to park, to civic plaza, urban plazas, then structural, and then what I call contextual. And the thing I would like to talk about, or would like you to notice maybe all through this is, whoops, I went too fast. Okay, there. The context of a situation is the more I work, the more I'm understanding, and the more it's becoming important to me, and hopefully I'm paying attention, and I know my teams that I work with are paying attention, is the context you're in. It's, we all want to do, I don't know about everybody, but I have these sort of, used to have these sort of favorite things I wanted to do, these sort of grand ideas. And in the end, what you really have to do is what fits. And forget everything else. This is an interesting image about talking about context, because I'm sure, and I don't even know who the architect is, it's a building I absolutely adore in New York because it has got so much movement to it. But it was designed as a standalone. And as soon as you move your eyes, you know, whoever was the architect really didn't like that building next to it. But guess what? So they stepped it back a little bit and they pulled off to the side of it. But they were ignoring their context. And I think in architecture this happens maybe a little bit too often. And in landscape, it's maybe we're the menders, maybe we are the people to try to make it fit, make that context fit in, because architecture is extremely complicated, and between its program, its cost, and maybe there's a way forward. And I think that Shell Petroleum, the next slide, is really where the architecture and the landscape work together, and they work within a context. Shell Petroleum is one of the best collaborations I've had with architects. The architects are Valley de Piste, a very good cabinet in Paris. Underneath those land movements are four stories of parking, public services. I didn't get a pointer somehow. I'm being terribly disorganized here. Do you have a pointer? Cool. I'll try not to make them wobble. No. Underneath here is all the different layers. And our work starts where there's not a roof. This project is where the saying came from, if there's sky, it's mine. We really like to integrate everything that is exterior to a building with everything that the building needs. So right here is all your emergency fire exits, you have your smoke exits here, and you have all your ventilation for the underground parking integrated into it. The land movement is a way that I've used traditionally to express concepts. The concept of Shell Petroleum is what they do. They go into the fluids of the earth through the rocks. Through those fluids, they refine them and they create energy. Energy that we all use. One of the things about Shell, it has a corporate image, but it also has a human image. And these are the back gardens of Shell, where the person is sitting at their office every day. And again, we're talking about context in that, what do they see every day? What do they experience? There is a lower water garden, and these bridges connect the office block over to the different areas, such as cafeteria, banking, conference, etc. There's 3,000 people that work for Shell. It's basically a small town. All the gardens are lined up on a grid that takes the building grid and pulls it out towards the future. It's a very futuristic company in the way it thinks. They've taught me a lot, and I enjoyed working with them. This is another land movement piece, and this is every time you're going to see a built and a non-built. This is pretty much halfway built. It's in Marseille, France. And to give you a situation, it's a major interchange that was built about 20 years ago. This goes up to Paris. This swings over to Italy. This comes into Barcelona, and this goes into Marseille. You can also get to Marseille by swinging around this way. The Marianne, the airport between Aix-en-Provence and Marseille is here. So it's really a, what we call in French, a chanière. It's one of the biggest interchanges in all. It just ripped through that landscape. It did one of those typical highway engineering things. It's absolutely beautiful in that this area, which are these mountains here, you have a 100-meter drop that drops into the plains and into the agricultural. You have what is the umbrella pine here, masses of them, and you can see how they worked in here and here and how this whole interchange just cut straight through them. It's a site that I've been coveting for years and was extremely happy to get as a land movement piece. And my brief was basically fill it with a million cubic yards meters of soil and make an entry to Marseille. No budget. They were digging a tunnel, and they had all this soil coming out of the tunnel, and they wanted to use it. One of the very confusing things is, because it's spaghetti land, is watch these eyes. These two eyes are going to be a guide for you about how we solved this. The design of this dates to 1993. Shell Petroleum was designed in 1989. The main idea was to try to give people a sense of where they were and all also recognize the natural landscape features. I work a lot in clay. It's the only way I can sort of figure out where I am in space. The plan just doesn't do it. So this is this wonderful mountain range that is up here that we saw in the aerial photograph. It steps down 100 meters to the plains here. I built two canyons. These are walls that are, they vary from 2 meters to 12 meters high here. By building those walls up, I was able to fill this entire area here. By also, you have an enormous drainage problem because your impermeability is in the surface. All of this valley, which I call the Sacred Valley, picks up drainage and drains down the center area, which makes it more bright green here. It's very biblical, this area. As you come up here on the freeway, you get to a crest, and when you're on the other side of the crest, all of a sudden, the entire Mediterranean opens in front of you. It's absolutely spectacular. The other thing is that there's a lot of rock, a lot of terraces, so we terrace this down using the native vegetation that was found in these hillsides. This is a basin that is the retention of water. You see it in the drawing over here. This is a farm that got caught in this development and is still there. And here in the plains here, we put olive trees and terraces that picked up all the vernacular that comes in here. And you can see it in the drawing there. Then the triangles are what we're calling the triangles of flowers. They represent the fields of flowers in the south of France, mostly poppies, that pick up in these areas here. Right now, these walls are entirely built, and the earth is set in place here. It may never get sculpted right, because that's the way sometimes things go. A couple more images of it. This is 50 hectares, to give you some scale. These are some drawings of the client. It's not my style of drawing, but I think it's interesting in that it shows this retention basin for water. Put some concrete columns in here that actually get water lines on them. The problem with water is everybody uses it and nobody knows where it goes. By filling up this basin, the people get to see actually how much water gets stocked in there. And then as the water slowly seeps down, because what you're trying to do is slow it down so it doesn't get thrown into the system at too fast a rate. These are pampa grasses that grow natively there. So when the water is totally down, those feathers of those pampa grasses will blow in the wind as if there was water. And as you're in the freeway here, at one point, you come to zero and you are at water level here. And then you go into the canyons here. And that is shows the model of those canyons in that area. This is Terrason, so we're moving into the park area. This is built. It's 8 hectares. It's in the Perigor, France. It was completed in 1995. The conception was done in 1992. A really fantastic team worked on this. There's Frank Noe, who actually did this illustration, who is a French landscape architect. He's also an archaeologist, which is very interesting. There's Anton James out of Australia that worked on it in the competition stage, and there's Philippe Marchand, who's a French landscape architect and architect that gave his blood and life to this project for 3 years. Ian Ritchie was asked to come in after the competition to help us. He designed an exhibition space here. It's a beautiful village that starts 12th century in here, and there's a river right through it. The point where you're standing here looking down is that point right there. There's a national road that comes through the town. This is the Perigord. There are 2 million visitors a year that come through this area. The town was not getting any of the tourism. So they had a competition that said, we want to stop the tourists, so we want to do a garden that they called the continents of the world. And so they wanted Little Italy, and they wanted a little Japan, a little Nantes, and they wanted a little Disney. So we said, no, you can't buy history, you can't reinvent it. What you can do is maybe explain it. Maybe you can talk to about the history of gardens and how they're composed, a bit like you talk about Greek architecture. Show them a column, show them a plan, show them, tell them how it's composed. So every time they go to a historical garden, they say, oh, that's why that's there. And you advance the knowledge of historical gardens, thus contemporary gardens. Everything's interpreted into a contemporary form. This is the perspective. It's a false perspective. It's a land movement piece. So as you see it looking up, it looks white, shall we say. And then when you walk around the back, everything's blue. So everything's constantly transforming as your body moves through the space. We are going to walk this way, back down this way, through here to the water garden, back down, and back through there. This is a hillside that wraps around. It's a 25% slope throughout the site. So it's very hard to get universal access. There are navettes that take people from a park in here and pull them up and drop them off here. From that point, everything is universal access within this range. And the only point that's not universal is this walkway right here. So we felt that was a pretty good feat. As far as garden history, some of the things that are in here is the water garden, the rose garden, suspended rose garden. There's here the element garden that we'll walk through. It talks about how we've hybrided plants. We'll take a native plant, and we hybrid it and hybrid and hybrid it until we create rooms with it. It's one of the fantastic things about garden history is what the Renaissance did with space. And they used plants as an element of construction, and they used plants to create space. So you'll have a boxwood that at one point just grew wild, and then as soon as you get into the Renaissance, the boxwood or the Texas vacata, you, all of a sudden just becomes a wall. So where is that limit between what a plant is? Is it always a plant, or is it a material? And how do you use that, and how do you make the historical garden understood within that context? So here we go. The name of the town is Terrason. Again, context. It was covered in forest that started in oak and went down to acacia in the lower area. We probably cut 5 trees during the whole process. We came in and we barely just very implanted things as it was. So as you look at the photos, remember we only cut 5 trees, which is pretty phenomenal in such a big space. There are natural sources everywhere. So every time you turn around, the water's popping out of something. So as you come in, the first thing that greets you is water. Boxwood is native, and it is everywhere. And so water and boxwood are your guides that lead you in. Through the boxwood, there are what we call the water stairs that you never see them until you're perpendicular to them. And then as you move up, we started building up dry stone walls and a gabion structure. This is an entry. This is a paying garden. So you pay at this point, but you've already been through an experiential piece before you get to it. This leads up into the element gardens, or you can shortcut up to the exhibition center here. As you walk into the element gardens, you go through an initiation piece, and then there is a gold ribbon that's 1,000 meters long that trails through the trees and is suspended to the trees, and it is your guide through these gardens. These gardens are 4 of them. They take a native plant and show today how that native plant has been hybrided in today's horticulture. So here is boxwood. One of the gardens is the fern garden. Here is some images of it. And the staircase, which is this one, that leads up into the next garden, which is the moss garden. Very simple forms. The moss garden was really interesting. It was the first one built. And the town people used to come up and sneak up on Sunday and sneak into the site and break down the barriers and get in through the fences. And they were very, very against the garden because there were only 3,000 people in this huge garden being built. The financing for this was federal. It's the state government of France, it's the Minister of Tourism, the Minister of Culture. It is Europe, it is the region, it is the department. So it's the mayor was very good, and he is an industrial businessman at getting financing together for this. It still was quite a shock to a small town to have something this large being built right on their hillside looking down at them. So they'd sneak out. And this piece, we had gone through the site and picked up stones and placed them in layers here. And then we had done some different treatment to get the moss to grow in them. And they would come up and say, oh, the best thing there is what was there naturally. And so probably one of the biggest compliments that's ever been paid, that they absolutely love that this is planted with white lilies in between all the terraces. Obviously, lily is the flower of realms and of justice. As you come around that area, the next thing you... Oh, I should go back. You come out of that area, then you come down into this grass area, and this is the exhibition center by Ian Ritchie. It was designed to look like a body of water that reflects the sky. It is very, very discreet. It's very ingenious how he designed it. It's based on the cold greenhouse, the cold serre, where there's no heat control. And this wall here, the sun, full south sun, comes in and hits this wall there. It is one of the first freestanding gabion walls. It's 6 or 7 meters high. There is an air gap right here. This structure holds the roof up. So the sun comes in here, heats this extremely thick wall. In the summer, when it gets too warm, this wall has water jets on it. And the westerly wind comes from behind it. And because it's a dry stone wall, the air gets naturally air conditioned by the wind through this wall. Above, at the platform, is an amphitheater that faces the roof of this piece here. It's made out of metal, just plate metal, and some land movement. It's for 250 people. This is the Axe of Winds that talks about axes and historical gardens. These are 12 meters high. This is about 4 meters this way. And a lot of people don't really think about weather. They don't think about wind. They see it sometimes, or they feel it. But what we've done is try to understand the turbulence of it also. So if you see, this fan here picks up drafts, and this one picks round this way. And so they're constantly moving on a gyrator that lets them move freely the way the wind moves. And then there are bells attached, so you get to hear them also. And they sound like cowbells. As you come over the top passage, you come into the water garden. The water garden is based on the historical cruciform form that you'll see part of it this way and this way. And it overlooks, this is the Rose Garden, Suspended Gardens of Babylon. That's 1,000 meters of metal structure that looks like a piece of fabric that's been floated in space. One of the things about pulling the water garden to the very extremity of the whole park, it irrigates people from one end to the other. So it makes your site get visited from one end to the other, and putting the most spectacular piece at the farthest point. Obviously, these trees, these poplars were here, so we sighted the entry through them into this piece. You can also arrive by the top walkway, and this is what it looks like as you come. This is the main cascade that is based on the gardens of Kashmir. The Mongols call it chatterwall, and it chatters, it talks as it goes down to the lower gardens. You can walk across this here. You can walk in between the jets, and here you see the cruciform forming, which is a very important back, way past before Egyptian time as far as a major, former of space. Some close-ups, another gabion wall. It's a dry stone area. All the stone comes from the area. And the whole water garden is surrounded by willows, so you feel like you've walked into water, and you're surrounded by water, and you're inside of water. This is a rose garden. After a couple of years, worked very closely with me on rose
roses, which actually donated all the roses. And this is the walkway. Canals have been very important in garden history as far as irrigation, about how they get the water to places. So both of these people are pieces about water retention, whether it's terrace retention or the canal retention. It's also about the future. Where are we going? How far are we going? And that's why it just drops off into the middle of the valley. As we come back through, thank you for keeping that going, Matt. I appreciate it. This is a topiary piece that's finally growing together, so it's a, like a tunnel you walk through, and as you see, you can see the shadow on the ground here, those correspond to pathways, and this is when you come out of this, this is what you experience, and this is the back blue of the false perspective that you end up walking through on your way back. And then you come into the last piece, which is called the Bois Sacré, the Sacred Woods. And it's an oak forest that was existing. We just added some native grasses, I guess you would call that. Grasses, flowering grasses. And there is, we put in it these stones, and there's five of them. And they're 2 meters by 2 meters, and they have the major deltas of the world that were the berceau de civilisation, in French, I don't know how you say it, the origins of civilization, the origins of gardens, of nature, and this happens to be the Nile. And so that water just slowly comes down here, and they're placed within here, and in the trees there are 50 bells. That move with the wind, and they're very, very small bells. So you have this movement of almost a meditative sound of the chimes that comes through this area. And then you come out, and guess what? You're in the boutique. This is Amsterdam, so it's very hard to explain for me because it's unbuilt. And it's a very important in that this is Central Station right here, and so this is the historical canals that have that semicircular pattern. Then from here you start breaking into the grid. You're right here is an historical 18th century park that and one of the main canals that connects right into Central Station there. These are the main lines that are the train lines that come this way, and this is our site, which you're seeing right here. Right there is that historical, there's the main canal. The historical has 22 historical buildings. It's an ex-gas factory. It is a polluted brown site. The buildings have been squatted for a number of years by the arts, and you have a new neighborhood that is building up very, very strongly here with residential. An existing neighborhood here and another neighborhood there with passages underneath the trees happening at this point. And then here you have what is this area that goes all the way out to sea, what they call the natural area. So you really have this site that is a between city and nature. This is what it looks like, that nature area on the other side. And this is the canal with the historical buildings. It was a competition that we won in 1996, I believe. 97. What we wanted to talk about, and this is the project, is the changing attitudes in landscape and how we are moving constantly in the way we think about landscapes and the way we design landscapes. That, especially when you have something like an 1800s, 1850s, picturesque English influenced garden here. Right here is the main house, so you're really at the heart of the Industrial Revolution. You have the pet home, the owner here, living in his house, and you have all his industry here that he can keep a good eye on. And then you have his private park right behind. that's enough comment about that social structure, but the social structure has changed, luckily, and our attitudes towards landscape have changed with it. The natural area here is an attitude about landscape in that it is a very native, only native, do not touch, you know, let's see what happens here. It's very interesting working on native in Holland because it's all sea, right? And so, you know, I say, okay, what's native is shells and fishes, right? But so you have to ask, when did native start? So they gave us a date. They said 1940. I thought it was fantastic. But what they were really trying to say is, if there was land here, what would grow? And so what they've created here is almost experimental about what would grow in that area. If you try to look about what happened between this period and this period, you have a whole area that is what I call sort of the 50s and 60s, where landscape was more about recreation. It was more about open space, and it was about agriculture. Not a lot happened in landscape, obviously. Things happened in the 30s, things happened. But basically, between World War I and the end of World War II, the whole world wasn't moving along. There were bits and pieces down here and there. But as far as man's attitude towards landscape, that's where the suburban sprawl started. That's where we started to see where we've moved away from this module into this type of module here. The question I ask today is, where are we going? You can't go back to nature completely, because then you're completely ignoring man, and I don't think we're going to go away. So how do you find that balance? Where is that balance between man and nature? So this whole area is trying to talk about that, whether it's successful or not, trying to improve, and where we're going with the time of the altar. The second layer to this is that you have two poles that are trying to do two different things, or are they different? One is all the artists and all the culture. They want their studios, and you have the people, city of Amsterdam, that wants a very public place for the greater public of Amsterdam. Then you have your neighborhood. And all the neighborhood really want is just art. They just want green. They want to walk with their kids and walk with their dogs. So you have a lot of pressures coming on this, plus it is horribly polluted. And how do you make all that work? One of the first things that they did, there was a building right in here that we just tore down and made it into an office. And it's a vertebrae. And everything comes off that vertebrae as these spaces. These are huge gas holders here. These are buildings here, and buildings here, buildings here, buildings here. And you saw those buildings, they look very much like a village. And if you put the central axis here, then that village became sort of like a mall type thing. It lost its privacy. So by pulling the central axis over here, that becomes a typology of space. And so the very, very traditional market squares here, a very traditional organization of the space, there's some very large trees here. So what we've done is taken that forest and pulled it diagonally across the side. And within that forest, we've talked about the changing attitudes of landscape, where this is very, very 1950s, 1900s, it's rhododendron, it's very, very controlled. And that control turns into a very non-control issue here, where I'll show you more images as we get through. These two gas holders have water in them, and the water is lower, so you actually go down in and you float on water with aquatic plants. What this also does is creates a bunch of performance spaces that are different sizes. This is a major performance space here for a very large rock concert. You have another space that is here, you have another space that is here, you have theater, different things you need to theater, you have big theater square here. Basically, as you move across this, you start to It's on site. We hope to be finished by the end of 2002. This is just some details of the castle that shows how carefully we've used all the materials that are on site. This shows the big manifestation plan for the water structures here. As you know, there's a paper plan here, the children's area, you can see we have the water that comes in. We have taxodium, which is called the bulb cypress, which is the frozen water. You see we have a line of floating trees here, which are like this. And then you move into these grassy areas here. As you, these are some of the, we had a lot of public consultation on this. It was a year to work with the public. It was very organized by the Dutch. It was organized by subjects. It was very effective in getting the public behind us. It was a lot of long nights. Neil did, Porter did a lot of it. It became more diplomatic than mine. But it was good because in the end we had the people who were the users part of the park. And we did a lot of changes to the park to make it work, to make it work for them. In certain areas where they just said no way, it was destroying it. We had a very strong client who said no way at some point, who said let's try to move this, let's try to open this up. A client that was very organized and helped a lot. This is Theater Square, the sun sits here. It looked very much like this. It was through the grasses. There's a restaurant, hopefully, going to be built here. Mecano Architects will be redoing these two buildings and maybe some of the others. We're not quite sure. The building is a lagging behind me. This is the wet garden. You come down into it, so it's a very intimate garden. And it's really talking about all the big, what I call the big leaves of the wet. It's very intimate. It's very textural. It's very opposite of the big manifestation here. It's someplace where you can just be quiet and be within a really garden-esque type of situation. On the front side, we lower the edge of the wad of the, this is called the plage in French. It's like a beach that you can roller skate on or you can do performance on. But one of the big things was we lowered the section of the actual place in the building because you had immediate authority above the water, so you never felt it. So by lowering it, you actually made the urban beach here, and there is the sculpture point. So you go out, and this is full south, so you go out to the center, in the middle of Amsterdam. This is back to built, non-built. This is Evry. It's been very public, so I'm going to go through it very quickly. It's a 130 meters tall ground. It's a public plaza. That this is Mario Botha's new cathedral. This was finished in 1992. So it's an older piece, but I think it works very well in that it integrates a lot of different problems. Again, context. What are we trying to do? What are we trying to make fit? This is a boulevard. It's called a national road in France. It can never be taken out. It's part of their entire federal system. So, and there's a 2 meter drop from here to here, so you can the sun comes like this. You basically have a plaza dropping into a very high speed boulevard. So, what we did is we dropped the plaza here and then stepped back up. That created a plinth of horizontality for these buildings, which created separate height of entrance for each building. The Chamber of Commerce is over here. We also did the underground parking, which is in the 30 places underneath. You take a car, you come in here, you park underneath this, you come back up here. These are the pedestrian entrances. One of the things that we, it's called the Human Rights Square, and so the Human Rights is a declaration of perhaps the city took number 13, the right to have expression and freedom of expression. So this is a performance space. This is seating coming down, the balcony coming down. And when it's empty, it's incredible. Terrace and then right here. So we made all the entrances for pedestrians totally different for people like me. I hope other people do this. Also, there's that problem of that transition between underground and above ground. So we've taken all the water and the light and we drop it into the parking garage below. So you're always seeing light, you're always hearing water drop in, and so it's something pulling you up. We're going to walk up here to this point. That is called the sleep sedge. And that's to lean on, to watch the performance here. And when you go in to pay for your ticket and you're underground, this is what you look at in the slit in the wall. Here, go back. That wall there, that's, that last picture was, you were behind that looking out. This is the dragon basin, 170 meters long. It's got a granite, and it actually is like a, it replaces a balustrade, and it gives you that plant. And the water comes off the edge to keep, make sure that water is always skimmed and clean. And then there's a light underneath here that catches that water running down that and reflects it on this at night. So that wall is always moving. It's a place that has serenity and joy. Don't believe they have not maintained, so it's one of the sadder projects. Maybe one day there's a new mayor there, so I have hope that they might start maintaining. This is the unbuilt project I want to show you on Civic Plaza. This is Seattle, Washington. Extraordinary natural beauty. Those are the Olympic Mountains across the bay that you're looking at. And this is a city that is built up on hills, very much like San Francisco. But it's really like an Italian hill cap that has this. The other thing it does, Seattle, that's absolutely fabulous, is it has put its streets on a grid perpendicular to the bay. So as you are on an avenue, every time you look down the street, you have water. And it's just like these slices between these buildings. And so you have a relationship that San Francisco has absolutely grown because they didn't build up on their hills, they built in their valley. And so they added all the topography of the downtown is actually makes that city look like it's flat instead of using the hill. Seattle has not done that. And so you have a constant relationship to this bay. The project is for a new civic center, and it covers three blocks. It also is dropping, I think it's 50 meters from here, and the bay is down here. So it's a huge drop. It's very hard to deal with. There's three different architects, two different architects really right now at this point. There will be a third platform when we get to this. This is new police headquarters, this is new justice, new city hall. MBJ is doing this, a big firm in America, Peter Boland, out of the East Coast of the United States, is doing this building. And ZGF, I believe, probably doing this building, or at least will be doing the transit center. The underground transit subway is on 3rd Avenue. The city bought a tower here. All your employees are coming here trying to get up 50 meters into this building, and that building. So you have a lot of vertical employees. The other problem is trying to create a plaza when you have a building that is taking up half of a block, and these streets are 19% grade. So trying to get a normal ceremonial staircase to the city hall, we can't even fit it on the site. So what we ended up doing is shoving it right through the center of the building. And the good thing about that, it makes the landscape and the architecture become one. The other concept we worked a lot about is, like in Seattle, every time you look up, it's like a rooftop,
also brick, but when you get into the more civic buildings, it tends to be that light limestone. So every time you look up, all of our walls are picking up that color, and they're all built up like terraces. But when you turn and you look down, you have a stone that looks like water. And so every time you look down, you see the stone looks like water, and you look out and you see the bay. And so it's as if you've taken the bay and brought it to your feet, or you are the bay as you move out. So those are the two guiding principles in trying to connect the entire site. The other one was that we connected it with water that comes all the way through the site, through the building, passes down, creates a water feature, crosses the street again, creates another water feature, then passes down and goes down three stories down to the subway station, which light has it also. So you have, this is the Cascade Mountains, this is the northwest of America, there's waterfalls everywhere, there's snow everywhere. It's really, the natural environment is very important. It is a civic center plaza. How are you going to connect nature? That's why most people live in Seattle is nature. They don't live in there for their museums and other things. But the natural environment is something that can exist and happen in the world. So trying to get that back into and make it part of the civic center is very important. This is one of my classroom models that showed the connectivity. They wanted a major civic plaza, but by the time you put a building here, you don't have much left. So what I did is, instead of letting this part step down, which meant all your energy would be going downhill, actually lifted it up and created one plaza that is the entire area. So there's very big public gatherings. You close off the street and you take out the entire wall. This says we are on site at the Justice Center and we're in construction documents right here. The water starts here. This is 24 feet, which is down this street. So I can't remember all the different measurements, but I think it's 24 feet here of glass, colored glass. Tim McFarland is the glass engineer working on this. And it folds underneath this piece of water, and we have natural water air bubbles coming up underneath the glass that are reminiscent of the hot springs in the Northwest. And that water starts its cascade across the area. This is the entry to the justice, the entry to the police. The police and the justice do not want to speak because we need conflicts with each other, so they have to have separate entries. By creating a public plaza in the center here, we created a very specific entry for the Justice Center and a very specific for the police. This shows some of the grade changes. So the main staircase comes up here. I've got to go back. It's so hard to explain this part. You have elevators that come in the base here that come up in this building, and they're on grade here behind restaurants here. And the surprised me about it. You have this historical context in this mother building. This is 30 years tall. And so there's no way we're going to turn this back. So you might as well embrace it. Because it is going to be the plaza just by its volume, just by its scale. So what I bought a book called, you know, probably 80 years, astrology. Which is just a very weird star cluster, and I love it. It didn't have a name, it had a number. And unfortunately, more fortunately, the director of the museum, nobody knows him 11, but they really know it's Orion. So Orion replaced M11, which is fine. And it's fiber optic, all through here. These are the teaching tables by along. And you can see this water just flows from this edge. And it's just this continual flow, and there's water jets, and we want to have a sit-down dinner, obviously, you turn off the jets. But kids love it. They play it at night, and it's magic, because it just reflects everything. A quarter of an inch of water makes it a Terry Farrell. He's doing the sports center here and has some housing in there. This is 100 Avenue Road. It's an existing complex, very high building, 100 Avenue Road. You have a theater school within that, a beautiful school. Central School. There was a full soccer field in the middle of this thing that took up this entire area. When the theater came through and the soccer field, this thing was so bit up, there wasn't anything left. Also, a lot of level changes made it very unsafe to work in. So we came in and said, okay, let's try to figure a place that has a lot of different diversity. Also, the soccer coach that was here, these two poor people in their residence were constantly pounded by the ball. Huge noise problems. There's players here, waiting for the residents. The old theater was here, so that whole area opened up, and this is a very noisy building. What we wanted to do is create a place that responded to the theater, had places that was very open in the sun, and just hanging out on the grass, possibly a water feature, but also an outdoor amphitheater. The program asked us for a half a football pitch, which we put in here connected to the recreational center, but also are working on making it that it is a space that we could have other activities in at the same time. You can see the model here. We created two very strong, more garden areas. One is here that we've just been working on planting that is going to be very, very colorful because it has so much sun with alcove seating. So this becomes a space. This becomes a space. That is a space. And this is a space. We basically had six different spaces in one. None of them have the change of difference in level so big that you can't see over them. So as far as security, one of the problems with the old place is that you had blind corners, you had places that felt dangerous and dangerous. All of these spaces will connect visually, as you can see in the model here, but at the same time, they just slip in. This will be a shade, natural woodland gardens here. This is another open garden. A lot of sunshine gets in this area there. Children's play area is moving into this area here. Entrance to sports center is there. We've been working on a water feature here with jumps that you can play in. Again, that you can turn off and have a play. A real theater play, outdoor theater, or a band, or a concert, where this becomes a concert area. And these are just some of the different materials and details. We have two axes of trees right in this area, this way there. I'm very excited about this. These are some of the drawings I showed you. We have four different pieces of practice. Gives you some idea of the space relationship, how you can be very open, but then you can be very intimate. This is South Coast Plaza, non-built built. South Coast Plaza is in Southern California. It is towards Laguna Beach. And I never thought I'd work at a mall, but it's a mall. And it's a very curious mall because it's a luxury goods mall. It has Prada and Jill Sanders and Tiffany and Chanel and Tudor Park all the way around it. And I've never seen anything like it. It's like Avenue Montaigne a la California. it's very weird. The owners are very extraordinary, though. They're the Sigurdsson family. They commissioned California Scenario by Isman Noguchi. They have a very large art collection. They're very educated. They're absolutely charming, wonderful, great clients. They have this complex that is 12 blocks, is that about right? Yeah, it's 3 by 3. The first 12 is where California Scenario is. It's all the banking. It's got Pelley buildings on it. It's got Helmut Young buildings. I mean, it's got the fabulous architecture on it. It's all banking, finances, and performance. The next 12 blocks is South Coast Plaza Mall, which is all clothing wear, basically clothing, jewelry clothing. Then the next 12 blocks is women. It's Conrad, it's Peter Barrow, it's all luxury homeware goods. The problem they were having is they couldn't get the people from this one to come to this one because they had a street between them and a sea apart. So nobody wanted to cross it, and especially in California. Getting outside of your car is just non-fay. So crossing the street is non-fay also. So that what they wanted was a plaza and a bridge that would take people across. And so that's what I was lead design on. James Tolson and Ellery Beckett, also my husband, helped me on this as far as the architecture. He's an architect. This is the model of the plaza. And I worked on, in context, California. This is a plain, this whole area started out as an area that had no water. And the Army Corps of Engineers came in and grabbed all the water out of Colorado, they all dug down Southern California, and then all of a sudden you have agriculture. And then it's an area that is constantly shifting, constantly developing. So you go from agriculture, and actually this would be Lima Peace. From that, it became developed. And so you constantly have this human use of land that's changing. But then in Southern California, the whole land is changing. Everything's shifting all the time on you, between the earthquakes and the plates and everything else. So it's called the strata garden, and everything is plates. One of the things here, the tremendous woods, this big parking lot here is right over there. So you have one entrance that comes through here to the main mall. This is Mason. There's an entrance there. They don't want people to go to Mason. They want them to come in here. Right? So it's a very linear getting people right into the mall here. At the other point, you want people to get up to this bridge. And so there's a gradual stepping up to a movement of grand staircase, elevator, escalator, and the end of the bridge, which is here. It's also like in California, the plates are slipping and they're rotating on each other. So it splits level here, which creates a crack or a fissure in the earth that becomes the water piece here. In the water piece, it has like the hot springs in California. It has air bubbles that just come up a certain point, totally at random, and create a very quiet spot right in this area here. The concept of the bridge was based on flight, and there are huge bird populations in this area of California, and it's the flight over and the flight taking off. There's another reason also that wanted people to look up and not look down, look at the mountains, look at the beyond. this is when the bridge first started getting built. All of a sudden you got up on it, you got to see all the hillsides and all the sky. And what we're trying to, I was trying to get people to not stop looking down at the parking, but start looking at what's around them. And those outriggers are 40 feet long. And then there are cables between them. And there's bougainvillea that were pushed out to this cable here. You see the holes here. It's a 5 to 14 feet. Wide walk. So basically, what's happening is you get the walk on the paint across this whole thing. If you just have a whole wings of bougainvillea that carry you across. As it comes to the end, it's a very yin-yang composition where the staircase comes here and the bridge takes off this way. This is the escalator, the elevator, down to the cafe. This dips down into a loading dock. Everything's built on structure. We have loading dock coming underneath this that service all the buildings. Clad in stainless steel. It was actually very complicated to do the bridge because we could only touch down in two different things. And so it's a 200 meter long bridge and it has three columns. This is some of the other views. Each piece of stone, and you can see some of the layering of the stratus here. Each one is of a different color. It gets really very quiet, tranquil places in here. The trees are jacaranda and eucalyptus. This is the source pool that starts, as I said, it rumbles at you. And it's air that comes up, it rumbles, it's set on random, you never know what's going to happen. And then these bubbles float down the stream here. And you can see the grand staircase. This is the stacked wall of all the different stones that are stacking up the layers. It goes up. The bridge also has a double curve. That's lucky. It curves obviously in this direction and in that direction. The reason for that is so you feel like you're on a journey. So as you come up on it, you never see the very end of it until you get to the high point and then you see around it. And this is the bougainvillea growing. It's perforated here, stainless, so that you get ample shade, sun, and shade. Also, you get rain protection. An animal. This is one of the. I'll go fast. Are you bored yet? So you keep going? Okay. I've only got two left. This is National Botanical Garden of Wales. It's with Foster and Partners, very published. We did the interior space of it. Neil Porter and Peter Cully worked extensively on this. It was interesting, the directors of the Botanical Garden, these are the pictures they showed me when I first started on the project. And the greenhouse is a football field. It's basically 100 meters by 65. And they want to put Mediterranean in. So we're talking about context. We're totally outside companies. We're in Wales. And they show us these huge pictures. I mean, look at these landscapes. This is what they want to do. And it's absolutely fantastic how these multiple horizons. And then this is a drop-down landscape, you know, one, two horizons here. And, you know, absolute plant mass in pure English form that just fanatically interesting and wonderful people. And then from that they show me, but then they want to see this. They want to see that very minuscule thing. They don't want real pathways. They want natural pathways. And then they show me this. And they want to be able to torch the fields with fire so that you get the regeneration of seeds. That's this. And then they take me to this quarry in Wales and say, well, what we really want to do is have it look like this.
It was marvelous. It was absolutely marvelous. They said, if we could get Sir Norman to come and bring his greenhouse and pop it on top of this, we'd have everything we want. So if you look at it, it's a drop landscape with nice line and a whole bunch of very diverse areas and rock cut here and scree here. And that's what they were looking for, a way to express a lot of different types of landscape. So this is what they got. The gray glass house is an oval, and one of the things, the first thing I wanted to do is to say a building can never be bigger than a landscape. Impossible. But, so you've got to do something to that building that stops being a building, so it starts being sky. So what we did is we dropped into it so that we created horizon lines like that. And then the building just drops. This is a 6-meter drop from the ground floor. This is a new laughter from ground floor, 120, and this is 120. That these, all these terraces here fill different roles, different microclimates, mini climates that they wanted. What's also interesting is the juxtaposition between sun and shade. The sun comes up here and it sets here. So if you watch these walls, they're constantly changing about how the sun hits. So in the morning, this is in full sun. This is called a seepage wall. But by 10 o'clock, that is raising light. This is on the full sunlight. This is raised light. This is full sun here. So if you get to noon, that's hitting full light. That's hitting full light. That is. That's in total shade. This is in shade. These are just starting to pop. Sunset, full light here. You're getting lateral on this and shade there. So you're like in the Mediterranean where the light is so important. The constant between light and shade is moving all the time. There's a waterfall here. There's a slip here. So as you look down, it's like a secret passage. That like meter vision that says something's in there, something that says I want to go through those walls to go beyond, and that comes right through here. We scan my models, and this is a scan of it, and use them directly to do our construction work. This is the entry. Everything is done in sandstone. As you can see, it's a total surprise. The other thing we did, going back. Originally, the entry was here. We moved it to the side to get that long view that's moving this way. There are bridges across here and across here. So you can visit by coming here, coming here, coming down here, you can come back over here, you can come across here, you can come down there, you can go there, and go back up, and then, anyway, you can go all the way over the place. So these are the first terraces that you can down. Worked a lot on that juxtaposition between natural landscapes and artificial landscapes. One of the great things about the Mediterranean, you never know where man's hand and nature's hand is separated. They build their houses on rocks, and so all of a sudden you'll have a taille piece of stone next to a natural piece of stone, and then they do this. And so it's very, very old civilization. So how do you represent that? How do you make it apparent? We also wanted this area to flood. As you can see, it's starting to flood now. This area is wildflowers. This is where they're supposed to be able to burn things. I don't know if fire regs would ever let them do it, but they do make sure it's so these are some of the images just as it was being built. You can see that slip where the waterfall is. Really pulled the guardrails back, kept them specifically very unsophisticated, galvanized. This is coming into the waterfall area, what we call rock and roll. It's a very secret garden inside that area. Once you're inside, this is a seepage wall. Water drips down here, runs down here, runs down there, runs down here. And they can grow different things in here, different ferns. This
this is some of the detailing. I think contractors are going to do a good job. This shows your scale of opinion. So it really falsifies scale a lot. It really plays with scale a lot. So it looks a lot bigger than it actually is. The bridges really try to keep it thin, very sort of natural looking, very rustic looking as you float over the space. Staircase up the side. This is some of the walls. This is the universal access for the gabion wall here on the bridge holding it. We didn't do a planting plan, but we did what we call the matrix for them. This is a drawing I actually did in Washington, and one of the Irish Stokes flew over to Washington. They were so afraid of what I was doing, and it was going to work out. So it was great. It came 3 days, and I said, okay, I can't tell this man who's a botanical garden how to plant something. He's really pretentious. And also, he's going to change it. No matter what I do, they'll change it. Right? They'll fall in love with another plant tomorrow, or they'll find a new piece of their collection. So why plant it? Why not tell them, if you want to create a landscape, this is how landscapes are created. There's about distance, there's about perspective, there's about scale. And so this drawing was to give them a guide in planting, that for perspective, you stay low in front, use the brighter colors in front, and then as you go into the hills get more blue, they get more gray, you know, they get bigger. So you're falsifying the perspective and the scale relationship at the same time. So overlaid with this is an acetate that gives heights. So basically say, okay, you can go up to 37 meters here, but you've got to be that height and that color. And up here you can go up to 15 meters, you can go up to 14, and then you go to the gray green. But you have to stay within the color and the height. Theory should work. Reality. It may, over time, because they want everything native and you have to build everything from seed, over time, I'm still holding out hopes that it will work. This is some of the images of the opening. So it's floral, and it's actually, there's something lovely about it in that. And they did want wildflowers there. They have a lot of them. The eucalyptus up on top of the gray green, so there's a few people colored here. But people like it, the client likes it, it's fun, and look at that roof. Interesting scale thing, isn't it? When you look between the landscape and the roof, and you see more than the roof you think of the landscape, you think it's a certain scale. And if you hide the landscape and look at the roof, you think it's a dumpster. This is the last project I'm going to show. It's non-built. It's called the Garden of Forgiveness. It's the center of Beirut, Lebanon. It is obviously not built. We are hoping one day it will be built. It was an international competition that we won 2 years ago. So that happened. And this is a puzzle that Neil and I found in Lebanon when we were there. And it fascinated me how it was so much like the city, the country. It's torn apart. And it's a puzzle. How do you put the pieces back together? And I found it very interesting that this is Lebanon. It is a beautiful country. It has water. It is not a dry desert Lebanon. There's a reason it's been the paradise of the Middle East. You have snow-capped mountains. So you have sea. These dark things are the cedar of Lebanon trees. And this is the Beka Valley. It's very rich agricultural here. The concept that we used to win this was to say that forgiveness can happen, has to happen, but maybe one of the means to get there is to find something common. And what is common, you can't argue about. Food, family, and life. What is things that you all love, that you all cherish? And so we took the land of Lebanon and based the entire project on the natural land of Lebanon. And it is a very difficult site. It is a huge archaeological dig right in the middle of the city. It has three mosques and three Catholic churches all fitting onto the space. The archaeology goes back to Hellenistic, up to Roman, Roman Byzantine, and into the Middle Ages. I know nothing about archaeology. We are learning very fast. There are also a number of experts, and the experts don't agree on how you conserve archaeology. Now, there's certain people that say the best thing you can ever do is rebury it, record it, rebury it. And other people say, no, restore it so people can live it and see it and understand it. And then other people say, don't touch it. So, and all probably are right. You know, I'm not an archaeologist, I'm not a conservationist. But this is our site, and this is what we have had to deal with. This shows the different things that we're trying to call out that were very important about Lebanon. And I'll go a little bit quicker. Site is a very strange configuration of this. The key is here, there. And there is a mosque here, which is around the St. George's. I've never explained this project in public, so it's a little black on my side. It's a beautiful picture. So starting at the top, this in the cedars, a lot of shadows. These are some of the reference images we've used. This is the palm grove. This is universal access, 120 all the way down. As these terraces come to be still with lavender and wine. Into this area. Thank you for doing that. This is the eating table at the very top time course where the celebrated meals are. The Lebanese food is famous. Cooking is very important. The family is very important. And this is the symbolic table. The bathroom of Jesus villages and some of the other churches. The next area as we're walking down through that terraced area coming in here, there, this is south and the east west. This is the staircase stepping back up to St. George and the ground. So it becomes like an amphitheater space in here. These are the, according to the archaeologist, these were homes and these were the different trades that the smith was in, the hammersmith was here, the stonemason was here, the baker was here. So it's very much a village type of community. In that area right in here, into the wall between the visitor center, so these are stone movers that actually open and close, that open onto the plaza. So there's an interactive information in this area. This is a close-up of the herb, I guess it's the jardin de pente. It's perfume, it's spicy, it's all those odors. It's also a conservation, archaeological conservation area. None of the roots are very deep. Nothing goes in, touches the wall, and so. This is the Roman bath area. This wall here is that wall right there. It was very confusing when we first started going out there. This will be filled with water again. This area that we It's obviously if you ever build this, it's going to be a lot of time on site trying to figure out how to get this to work right and a lot of time in the archaeologist. But finding a place of calm in a city that has just been totally destroyed is really the goal. All these buildings have been destroyed. They're actually here, but they have balconies now. That is good here. These are all fallen cherry trees. And stepping up to the native plant up the wall that would be built here, you can see some of the Roman columns here from the cargo there. The next image is restoration of a cargo using the that is here. Or you go underneath the bridge and come up in an elevator there. This is the Dekadil here. That's you're looking down this way into some new development that's happening in this area. It's a really beautiful time. This is the cargo that we were looking at. This is another restoration that's there, is left there, and just put it back up in the place where it was before. For certain archaeologists, conservation leaders, believers, and that's how they can do it in our conservation. How this would be developed with water at the end. And yes, there's two St. Georges. This is the second St. George, and this is the heart of the monster. Finish on a light note, not everything is heavy. This is an installation for sensuous art that I did this year. And there's 150 of these little guys, no, 400 of these guys that twirl out from the bay in between these pompy grasses. And they move in the wind. It's called revelatory landscapes. It's supposed to reveal about something that happens in the landscape. So it talks again about the wind. Is everywhere, how wind plays seeds, plays sounds. These are the sound tuners. There's a big freeway behind here, it makes a lot of noise and everything else, but there are all these birds and many of these things. So these are galvanized. If you sit on them, they wrap around and you don't hear the freeway anymore, you can hear the birds. And then these guys spin around and catch the light. And that's the last slide.
So long.
Wonderful, incredible tour de force. Maybe there are
I'm sorry
one
to
or
kept
two,
you so long.
One or two questions. Maybe those people who want to One of the things that I think is great is the way that you're showing all these projects in a kind of seamless manner, whether they're in France or in the States or, you know, Swiss cottage and things like this. And but as I said at the beginning, because of your own sort of personal experience in France and then being here now in Seattle, there must be also quite different local circumstances, local forces, which you haven't talked about as much. I mean, I think it would be quite interesting if you could touch on your response in a way, how it is for you to work in these different conditions, because it seems to me that, for example, what's coming out of France now in terms of landscape is very different than the sort of thing that's generally happening in Britain. I mean, there seems to be a lot more people, they're much more active. Not so much, maybe, happening in terms of landscape. And also just the, while there's an incredible kind of cultural reception, I don't know how it is for you as a landscape architect. So just maybe you could say something about Seattle, you know, London, and France in terms of context.
Well, I thought I had, but maybe I didn't talk. I wanted to talk a lot about I feel like every project is about that person. And and the more I work, the more it's about that person. And about the history of the place, and what are the needs, what are the trying to accomplish.
That came across, I didn't mean the word context, I didn't mean anything in the physical sense. I meant in terms of
the people,
culturally, what it's like to practice.
Everything is different, and every practice is very good. The law of laws, the contract law, security laws, all that stuff. You know, it has a little bit of what's different about France is that American?
Sure.
They dumb everything down.
Right.
Oh. There's so much great to do.
Yes.
There's a lot in the world. There are so many things. Is that what I'm saying?
I'd like to know what other rules you gave the gardeners in the in Cardiff, the National Farm Reserve.
No, it's not Cardiff, it's in Middleton.
Because it's
marvelous.
No, but you said that you gave them height, but you seem to have got all these colours as well. Did you do anything else with them?
No. There were certain areas where, for security, so they used the other, or arranged spaces. But it was basically a different stick, sort of this color and this color. Because they do have a botanical garden has collections, and museums have collections of things. They have collections. And they really need to achieve the collections. And so if you give them too many constraints, then you're going against the grain of light it exists. And so, and I worked with Dr. Stoke, who's very important, and said, if they can do this, I can see it. And of course, in Australia, he needs to take it back to them. He said, I can do it. And I said, okay, that way you're going to have a big answer. You have a big answer. This is how you falsify your schedule. Work on scale that it can create the illusion of something more than just the
The business of sun passing across the landscape, does that have any reflection on the colors or the plants?
Well, it did in that they really asked me for areas that were full sun, not full sun, super tall, shade. They had all these plant communities that had very specific environmental needs. So those were a result of making sure they got those new environments. And so they're very, it was very sort of planned, and they're always using for the things to start happening. There's a lot of reasons for the future.
I want to take you back to the Amsterdam project. You didn't speak about it, but I know that it was a very contaminated site.
Yes.
And I wondered if you could say something about how you dealt with that in terms of maintaining the rigor of the design, because I think it's a very important issue about the balance between the sustainability and the design.
There was a lot of what we knew was pollution. But the first rule was you cannot take any chemicals. So the second rule was you had, because it's public, you have to have a meter between people and the contamination. It's not, when we designed it, we were told it's not an aggressive contamination. That has sort of been taken away now. Rules got broken later. The first rules that we were set out with is not needed to that. You have to be a meter away from it, and you cannot take it. So we worked with the Lutherans and their group, and a lot of land movement is based on getting masses of pollution into one place and covering it. And so that's why that whole amphitheater piece is back there. Or you see areas being raised up and then sliding back down, because you're trying to get away. go up and you will be in another area. So move a little bit over. And it was a very interactive between the two study groups about how do you get the balance in the side, how do you get the position, and still make it out of the things over this way, like a kite. What do you mean move it that way? So it's been almost 2 days with drawing kite, and he wouldn't get on it, but I wouldn't get on the kite. And so in the end, it really worked out well. The last bit, I was just pushing out the engineering plane, so I finished the last bit by myself. I was too much.